Good morning, everyone. Welcome to class. Thank you all for joining class this morning. Also, welcome to our e-learning students who will be listening to this lecture later on. We will continue with the last part of chapter 5, and then we'll move on to studying chapter 6 today. So before we do that, can one of you please lead us in prayer, please? Anyone can lead us in prayer?
Father God, we thank you for this new day and thank you for the opportunity to come together and to study your word. Lord, we pray that you open our hearts and mind to understand your truth and live that in our lives, Father, in Jesus' precious name.
Amen. Thank you, Nina, Santosh. So in chapter 5, we see that Paul lays the foundation of the truth of our identification. Can you please mute your mic, Prince? Thank you. Okay. So he says in Adam, who he calls the first Adam, he says we've all inherited sin. And because of sin, you know, death and everything else came as a result of that sin. And we became enemies of God. We were without strength. We were condemned. We faced the wrath of judgment and eternal judgment, which is hell, as a result of being part of Adam's race. And he says in Christ, who he refers to as the last Adam, okay, he says he's... you know, because of what Christ did on the cross, we have inherited or we have received peace with God. We've received the gift of righteousness. We are justified, made righteous, and we have received abundance of grace. And so we have the right standing in grace. And we are saved from the wrath of God. We have eternal hope. We can experience the love of God. We have the life of God in us. We reign in life over every demonic oppression and challenges which we face. And we bear the image or the nature of Christ in us because of what the last Adam has done. So this is a contrast that he is drawing out here in chapter 5. And we kind of saw that contrast just before we ended class last week. We also said that, you know, this is a very unique passage in scripture. Chapter 5 verses 12 to 1 is very unique because we don't find it anywhere else in the New Testament. And we saw that Paul calls it as the truth, or he refers this to as the truth of our identification, or the truth of as identification of who we are. And you know, he talks about how every human being is affected by that one man, Adam, and you know, and the consequences of what he has done, and what happened as a result of that affected the rest of the human race. Similarly, what that one man, Jesus Christ, has done is now available for the rest of the human race. So it's a very unique passage of scripture, verses 12 to 21. We studied that, and we also said that, you know, he mentions about this a little bit elsewhere in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 45 to 48. So can one of you please read 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 45 to 48, please? Anyone can read 1 Corinthians 15, 45 to 48.
Corinthians 15, 45 to 48. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a living, giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, and afterward the spiritual. The first man was of the earth, made of dust. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. and S is the heavenly man. So also are those who are heavenly.
Amen. You read till verse 49, right?
Till 48, ma'am.
Okay, can you read 49 as well, please?
Okay, ma'am. And as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also wear the image of the heavenly man.
Amen. Thank you, Nikhil. So here there's another place where Paul is drawing out a similar picture like what we studied in Romans chapter 5. So Adam was a type of the man to come. And who was the type of the man to come? That is Jesus Christ. So we see in the Bible there are very different, there are different types and shadows which point out to the person and the work of Jesus Christ. So we're saying that Adam was a type of the man to come, who is Jesus. And Paul here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 draws out the contrast as we see similar to what he mentions in Romans chapter 5. So here Adam is referred to as what? In verses 45 to 49, Adam is referred to as what? It's there in your Bibles. You can look at it. What is Adam referred to as?
First man.
Okay, he's referred to as the first man. Okay, what else?
Man of the dust.
Man of the dust, yes.
And the first Adam, I mean, he's in his...
Yes, first Adam. Adam, yes, yes, right. What else? First Adam, first man of dust, anything else?
Natural.
Yes, natural man. Thank you, Nina John. So here we see that, you know, Adam is referred to as the first Adam, the first man, the natural man, the man, you know, made of dust. Okay, a man who is also of the earth. Okay, how is Jesus referred to here? How is Jesus referred to here?
The last Adam?
Yes, the last Adam.
Spiritual.
Spiritual man, okay.
Second man.
Yes, second man.
And then the heavenly man.
Yes, heavenly man. Thank you so much, Nina John. So we see that Jesus is referred to as the last Adam, the second man, the man, heavenly man, and also the spiritual man. Okay, so here, you know, Paul is saying that the first man, Adam, became a living being, but the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. Okay, so why is Jesus called as the last Adam? Why is Jesus called here as, or referred to here as the last Adam? Any thoughts? Anyone likes to try? Think. Why is Jesus called as the last Adam?
Jesus is the Son of God, and he came through the power of the Holy Spirit and this finished the work of redemption on the cross.
Okay, so?
So that's why now we don't need anybody to come again and save us.
Okay, save us. Okay. Good try. Thank you, Nina Santosh. That was good.
She is the human who was like born without like involve of any man. He was directly created by God, like Adam.
Okay, he was born without sin. Okay.
and with Adam started the sin, and also with Jesus the sin was ended. So maybe.
Okay, thank you, Prince. Shiv Kumar, through Jesus's death, sin was put to an end. Okay, through Jesus, death was put to end. Okay, thank you. He's the only one who died and resurrected. Okay, thank you. Good try, everybody. Yes. So last Adam means that, you know, in Jesus, there is an end to the Adam's race. Not that, you know, technically speaking, you know, because we know that in Adam, the Adam's race continues technically. People are still born in Adam's race. But here we're talking about spiritually, right? Spiritually, Adam's race comes to an end. You know, we are dead to sin. We are spiritually alive in Christ Jesus. Okay, so that is why Jesus is referred to here as the last Adam, because in him, you know, there is an end to the Adam's race, which means we are spiritually born again. You know, we are spiritually renewed. We are born again spiritually in Christ Jesus. Yes, you want to say something, Prince? Okay, you can mute your mic. Okay, thank you. So verse 46, it says, however, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, and afterward the spiritual. So he speaks of the natural and the spiritual. So in the natural, he says Adam's race, you know, continues technically. People are still born in Adam's race, but spiritually in Christ, you know, is the last Adam, because like Nina Santo said, you know, there's no more, you know, payment for sin. There is no more a sacrifice for sin that is to be made. Jesus Christ made the full, sufficient, perfect sacrifice. And when we are born again, we are spiritually born again. And, you know, we are born in Christ. And hence, he is referred to as the last Adam. Verse 47 says, the first man was of the earth, made of dust, the second man of the Lord from heaven. So here he refers Jesus to as the second man. And the first man, he says, was natural, was from the earth. The second man is Jesus, and he is from heaven. So there are two races, so to speak. There is one race of people who are earthly, of the first man, Adam. And there's another race of people who are spiritual, who are in Christ and from above, who are heavenly. And for these people, it is the, you know, who are born from above, who are born spiritually. You know, when they are born spiritually, when they are born from above, you know, there is an end of Adam's race in them. And Jesus is the second man, which means he is the second man of the new race. That is, those who are born spiritually in Christ Jesus. So people born of the second man, they are spiritual and they are born of heaven. Verse 48, he says, and as the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. So those who are natural, you know, born of Adam's race, they all bear the image of the man, Adam. Okay. And we are like him, or they are like him. But whereas people who are born again, they are the spiritual people who are you and I, who've accepted the Lord Jesus as our personal Savior. We bear the image of the heavenly man. We bear the image of the one who is from heaven, that is Jesus Christ. That is why when we are born again, you know, our nature in our spirit man is born again, and our nature, it becomes more like Christ. We have the nature and the life of God flowing in and through us. We have the nature and the life of Jesus flowing through us, and the Holy Spirit is in us, is making our nature more like Christ. We are being made and transformed into more into Christ's likeness. Verse 49 says, and as we have borne the image of the dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man. So verse 49 says, we shall also bear. But if you read it in the Greek, it does not have a future tense to it, that we shall also bear. But it says, we now bear. Now, the word bear means, let it show forth, you know. So in these verses, Paul is saying that, we who are born of heaven, we who are born of the spiritual man, you know, that is Jesus Christ, we are born into Christ Jesus, you know, we would also bear his likeness. We would also show forth his nature. We would also show forth and be like him in every way. So here in these verses, Paul is, you know, basically doing a wonderful contrast. He's talking about the first Adam, first man, the natural man. He's talking about Adam himself. Then he's talking about the last man, the second man, the last Adam, the second man, and the spiritual man, who he's referring to as Jesus Christ. And he says the first Adam is a man from the earth, and the last Adam is a man from heaven. So he says that in Adam we all will die, but in the last Adam we will all live. And we all bear the image of the last Adam, who is the spiritual man from heaven. So Paul is basically writing all this to explain to us what is our identity, or what is the truth of who we are, the truth of our identification of who we are as a result of what Jesus Christ has done for us on the cross. Yes, we receive salvation through grace and in faith, but he's saying that, you know, what is the end result of this? What happens to us as a result of what Jesus has done on the cross is he's saying that, you know, this is what happens, and he's explaining the truth of our identification. Okay, so this is chapter 5 for us, and just wanted to mention where else he talks about this truth of our identification apart from Romans chapter 5, which is mentioned in verses 12 to 21. He also mentions it in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 45 to 48. Any questions? Any questions? No questions? Okay, if there's no questions, we'll move on to chapter 6, okay? I'll just give you a brief introduction to chapter 6, and then we will move on to read it. So in chapter 6, Paul is basically sharing what he has already spoken about, what we have received in Christ, our identification in Christ, that we have received the abundance of grace, we have received the gift of righteousness, and so he's, countering questions that people could ask when, you know, they read what he has written, you know. And some of the questions is, you know, should we continue to sin because God is giving us so much more grace because we are saved by grace through faith, you know, should we continue to can we continue to sin is one of the questions that will, you know, pop up in the mind of the reader. So, you know, Paul, even as he's writing this, he's, you know, thinking, okay, this can be the possible question that comes up. And then, you know, we are forgiven, you know, we are made righteous, we are justified by the grace of God. Okay, we understand that now, but how about living a life free from sin? So should we continue living in sin? Can we continue living in sin because the grace of God is so abundant? And so now he's thinking that his readers will have these questions, or these questions will pop up in their minds. So he's now transitioning to Christian living, And he's talking about how do we live our lives in the view of what Jesus has done on the cross for us, what he's purchased for us on the cross, and what has happened as a result of what he has done on the cross. So what is he bringing out in Romans chapter 6 is basically an in-depth understanding of the truth of our identification, which he has already introduced to us in Romans chapter 5, who we are in Adam, who we are in Christ. But he is taking it a little more deeper. He is taking us into a deeper look at our understanding of our identification with Christ. And what does that mean and how does it affect our lives? So, yes, not only are we forgiven of our sins, but we are delivered from sin. So we don't have to live as slaves to sin anymore. Okay. So he said that because of Adam's sin, we have all inherited sin, and as a result of it, death and everything else. But in Romans chapter 6, he says that we have been set free from the power of sin. Okay. And then, he explains to us how that happened. So, the title of this lesson is basically Sin's Power is Broken. So based on this title of this chapter, what is Paul basically talking about? Okay, he's basically talking about how the power of sin is broken. But you can say, hey, he's already spoken about sin. Yes, he's already spoken about a sin and salvation, and he's already done quite a bit of writing, and he's established quite a bit about sin and salvation. Now, what are some of the facts that he's already established? He's already established the fact that we are sinners, that Jesus died for our sins, that we are all forgiven, and that, you know, when we believe in what he has done for us on the cross, you know, his righteousness is being imputed upon us, or his righteousness is being put into our account. And hence, we are made righteous, we are justified, and we have a right standing in grace. So this is all everything that he has already spoken about in, chapters 2, 3, 4, and 5. Then we can ask this question, hey, why is Paul continuing to talk about sin? Like I mentioned in the introduction to this epistle that, you know, this is a letter and this is not written chapter and verse. So since this is a letter, and I mentioned that, you know, when reading this letter, we need to have a forward and a backward look, right? I hope you remember that. So what does introduce initially say in chapter 1, will be further explained or built upon later on in the rest of the chapters or in his letter. Similarly, when interpreting something in the later chapters or the chapters that we are still going to look at, we need to maintain a backward look, which means we need to look and interpret what we are reading now in this part of the letter or in this chapter and verse. We interpret it, we understand it, and we read it in the context of what was already introduced to us and what was previously mentioned, elaborated, explained, or stated about that subject previously. Okay. So that is what we need to do. And that is not just what we need to do when we're studying the book of Romans, but it's something that we need to do when we are studying scripture. You know, scripture always enlightens other scripture. Okay, so scripture also always interprets scripture. So if you want to understand any scripture, we all have to look at it in the context or in the light of the rest of the scripture. And that is what we call as doctrine. So when we are studying something, you know, or when we study a doctrine or a teaching in the Bible, we always study it and interpret it in the context of all the verses that has been mentioned, sorry, that has been mentioned, that has been spoken about in the rest of, or in the light of the rest of a scripture. That is when we are able to interpret it right, understand it right in context, or there can be misinterpretation, which can lead to a lot of problems and wrong teachings. Okay, so we in chapter 3, Paul talks about sin. He says, hey, we've already sinned, you know, and we are all have sinned. And, you know, the law or the circumcision does not make us righteous, does not justify us before God. But we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But we are justified and we have been made righteous by faith or through faith in Jesus Christ. Okay. Now, just like he raised several questions in that chapter to bring out the truth, similarly, in this chapter, in chapter 6, he raises up some questions, or, you know, in part of this letter, he raises up some questions as well to help us to understand. Okay, so he addresses in chapter 6 the main issue of the problem of sin by raising two main questions. And the first question is in verse 1, and the second question is in verse 15. So if you can please read Romans chapter 6, verse 1 and verse 15, can you tell me what is the first main question and what is the second main question, please? What is the first main question?
Romans 6:1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound?
Amen. So here the first main question he's trying to address, okay, the main issue of the problem of sin is, shall we continue to sin that grace may abound? What is the second main question in verse 15? Anyone can tell me what's the second question?
What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law but under grace? Certainly not.
Okay, so the second question, his main question is, shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? Now, to answer these two main questions, he has two follow-up questions that points to spiritual truth. So the first question, which is in verse 1, is, shall we continue to sin in that grace may abound? You know, there are two follow-up questions he asks for this main question, which is in verse 2 and verse 3. So can somebody tell me what is the follow-up question in verse 2 and verse 3, please? Anyone else?
Certainly not. How shall we, who die to sin, live any longer in it?
Yes, so the second question, sorry, the second question is, how shall we, who died to sin, live any longer in it? Yes, the third, the second part of the question, follow-up question, yeah.
Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?
So the second follow-up question is, do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? So these are two follow-up questions for the first main question. Now the second main question is, shall we sin because we're not under law but under grace? Verse 15. And so for this he has, you know, two follow-up questions that he uses to point out the spiritual truth. So the first follow-up question is in verse 16 and the other one is in verse 21. So can somebody tell me what is the follow-up question in verse 16 and what is the follow-up question in verse 21?
Know that to whom you present yourself slave to obey, you are that one slave whom you obey, whether of sin to death or of obedience of righteousness.
Okay, that's the first question. And the second one, verse 21.
What fruit did you have then in the things or which you are now ashamed? For the end of those who things is death.
The Thank you, Chira. So here, as Paul, you know, is responding to these two main questions, he has some follow-up questions to elaborate and bring out the spiritual truths. But as Paul is answering these two main questions, he introduces to us the truth about identification, okay, our identification, and how that has set us free from the dominion or the power of sin. Okay, so that is what he does in this chapter. And also he presents five action points that we must take to live a life free from sin and, you know, to live a life under the grace of God. And he also presents us with the truth that God's grace has made us free from sin. Okay, so this is what he's basically talking about here in this chapter. So, you know, what should be our response to God's grace? You know, our response to God's grace should be that we willingly make ourselves, you know, Paul says that we need to willingly make ourselves as slaves to God and as slaves to righteousness, which he says ultimately results in holy living before God. So he's presenting all of the truths of our identification, how we've been set free from the power and dominion of sin. And then he talks about the five action points that we must take to live free from sin and from under grace, and presents a truth of God's grace that makes us free from sin. And then he's saying what should be our response. Our response that should be that we should no longer be slaves of sin or slaves of unrighteousness, but we and slaves of Satan, but we need to make ourselves as slaves to God, slaves to righteousness. And when we do that, what is the result? We live holy lives before God. Okay, so with this background, let's study chapter 6. Okay. So can somebody read verses 1, 2, and 3 of chapter 6, please?
What shall we say? What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we, who died to sin, live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death.
Amen. Thank you, Nikhil. So having presented to us the powerful truth that we are justified by faith, and that where sin abounded, that grace abounds all the more, Paul is, you know, here going to address a question that people could ask or raise. So he says, shall we all just keep on sinning so that God can keep on giving us more and more grace? What do you all think? What do you all think?
No, obviously not, like Paul himself says.
Yes.
Because we died to sin, so then we can't keep continuing in it.
Yes, amen. We died to sin. We cannot keep on continuing. But did you know that there is some churches who, you know, are called the greater grace, and they have this whole concept that, and people also, you know, live with this concept that, you know, hey, why are you judging me for my sin? Or why are you looking at my sin? You know, when we have such a merciful, loving, compassionate, gracious, and merciful God whose grace is so abounding, who forgives sin, then why do you always keep on, you know, judging me for my sin? Or why do you always keep on pointing my sin or telling me I need to change? What do you all think about that? Have you come across people like this?
Yes, we have. I mean, here and there, there's a lot of it that goes on. So it while we are saved by grace through faith, other scripture also tells us that it's never a license to sin. I mean, if anything, it should the kindness of God should lead us more and more to repentance and good works and good life in the face of all that he has done for us. That should inspire us to live more like how he expects us to be. And as we have our identity, then that's what our life should reflect, and that's what our life should be.
Yes. Yes. Our response to God's grace, what should it be? That we are no longer living a life of unrighteousness and in sin, but we should be slaves of God and slaves to righteousness, which results in a holy living before God. And like Nina John, you correctly said that when we are dead to sin, you know, sin no longer has any authority and power. And that is when we say that, you know, the grace of God is made available to us. We are justified. We have been made righteous, right? Okay, so Paul is asking the question, and then he himself is answering, certainly not. These are rhetorical questions, which the answer is, you know, very implicit. And also he's also mentioning, gives the answer as well. He says, no, absolutely not. You know, or we cannot keep on continuing in sin because, you know, grace abounds. And he says, why? Because he says, we are dead to sin, right? And it's quite logical when you think about it, that people who are dead cannot sin, right? So dead people do not sin, and they cannot sin. So he says, we are baptized into Christ, and we are baptized into his death. So is he here talking about water baptism, or is he here talking about some other baptism? What is your idea? What baptism is he talking about here? Water baptism or other baptism?
Baptism into Christ.
Okay. Baptism into Christ. Yeah. Very smart answer. Yes, it's not. Yep. Sorry. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yep. When we are spiritually born again.
Okay.
That spiritual, like when you're receiving Christ, the change would happen in our spirit.
Okay. So you're saying it's spiritual baptism?
No.
Okay. Okay, so here he's not talking about water baptism. He's talking about some other baptism. And he's talking about spiritual baptism. Now, why do we say it's not water baptism, and why do we say it's spiritual baptism? Because he says we have, like, you know, Prince rightly pointed out, he says we have been baptized into Christ. Now, we need to understand from the language of the author what he would mean by saying that, you know, we are baptized into Christ. And then we need to look at what he's talked about this or mentioned about this anywhere else in scripture, or where else is he spoken about this in scripture. And he's he writes about this in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verse 13. So can somebody read that, please? 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verse 13.
By one spirit.
Go ahead, Nikhil.
For by one spirit, we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one spirit.
Amen. So here, you know, he is talking about, you know, Holy Spirit being baptized in the Holy Spirit into the body, or the Holy Spirit baptizing us into the body of Christ. And here he's not talking about water baptism as well, but he's talking about the Holy Spirit baptizing us into the body of Christ. Okay, so we know that water baptism is a physical outward expression of what we read in, you know, of what we read in Romans chapter 6, verse 3, that, you know, we are baptized into Christ and we are baptized into his death. Okay, so water baptism is that physical expression of that spiritual reality. What is that spiritual reality? That when we are, like Nina Santo said, when we are born again, our spirit man is born again, we are born into in Christ Jesus, we are born in Christ, into Christ Jesus, or we are born in Christ Jesus, and we also identify with his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, and him being seated at the right hand of the Father. So that is the physical expression of the spiritual truth or the spiritual identification that has already happened inside us. So water baptism is the physical expression of a spiritual reality that has happened. When we are born again, we are born in Christ, or born into Christ. We are baptized in with him in his death, his resurrection, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, and him seated at the right hand of God the Father. So what he's focusing here is on the spiritual truth. What is the spiritual truth that he's focusing on here? Is the spiritual truth is that all of us as believers have been baptized into Christ. Okay, that we are bought into Christ. That means we are one with Christ. We are made one with Christ. We are immersed into Christ. We are put into Christ, and we are clothed in Christ. So that is the spiritual reality that he is talking about here, or he's focusing on the spiritual reality that all of us have, as believers, have been baptized into Christ. We are brought into Christ. We are immersed into Christ, and we are clothed in Christ, and we are put into Christ. Okay. So when we are baptized into Christ, we are baptized into his death. That is what Paul is saying. So coming into Christ, now we identify with his death. That's why he says we are baptized into his death, means that we now identify with his death. And that is a powerful declaration, that is a powerful proclamation of the spiritual truth of our identification with Christ's death. Not only with his death, but I said his burial, resurrection, ascension, and him seated at the right hand of the Father. Okay, so this is something for us to understand, that yes, Christ died 2,000 years back, and here we are here 2,000 years later. When we hear the gospel, when we believe in Jesus Christ, what happens when we believe and accept him as our Lord and Savior? We are baptized into Jesus Christ. So we are basically immersed into Jesus Christ spiritually. Okay, we are brought into Christ or immersed into Christ. And what happened to Christ 2,000 years ago becomes effective in our lives, in our bodies today. And how is that possible? Because, Paul has already spent a lot of time explaining in Romans chapter 5. He says, because of Adam, or we being part of Adam's race, we have inherited sin and death, and everything that has come between sin and death has come upon us. And we have been affected by what happened 6,000 years back by one man's disobedience and sin. And so the same truth is continuing here. What has affected us as a result of one man's sin that happened 6,000 years back, Christ who died 2,000 years ago, when we believe in Jesus, when we are, we are baptized into Christ, we are immersed into him spiritually. And at that moment, we identify with him, we identify with his death. That is, spiritually, we identify with his death. We are made one with Christ spiritually. We are made one we are one in the body of Christ with God, and we hence are part of his body, and we identify with his death. And what he has done as a result of his death, you know, now becomes, you know, is something that we receive. Because what Adam did 6,000 years back, you know, we inherited that sin, sickness, and everything that came between sin and death because of that one man, Adam. So also the last Adam, you know, the second man, Jesus Christ, what he did 2,000 years back, when we receive what he has done, we also receive, or we also identify with what he has purchased for us, what he has received for us on the cross. So that is what he means by saying that we spiritually identify with Christ's death. Or it is talking about spiritual baptism and how we spiritually identify or made one with Christ. Are you all able to understand? Yes? Any responses? Yes, no? Okay. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
So here he's basically talking about our spiritual identification, how we identify spiritually with Christ's death, his burial, resurrection, ascension, and him seated with, you know, the right hand of God the Father. Okay. Then we'll move on to verses 4 and 5, identified with Christ. Can somebody read that, please?
Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection.
Amen. So Paul is saying, not only have we been baptized or immersed into his death, it's talking about spiritually, right? Since we are part of his death, we are also buried with him. When Christ was buried, we were also buried with him. So true baptism into death means we are baptized into his death spiritually. Not only are we buried with him, but just as Christ was raised from the dead, by the glory of the Father, you know, when he says Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, he means he was resurrected. So also we resurrected with him. Okay. So all this he's talking, you know, spiritually. Okay. So Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father. And we know that Christ was raised by the Spirit of God. That's what Paul talks or writes in the same epistle in Romans chapter 8 verse 11. Okay. Now, what is a Greek word for glory?
Doxa.
Yes, doxa. So doxa in Greek is often referred to the nature and the works of God revealed through us. So it's basically a manifestation of who God is and what he does, okay? And it's a demonstration of the power of God. So we understand that the Spirit of God causes the glory of the Father to be revealed. So Paul is saying here that, hey, we have received the abundance of grace, the gift of righteousness, but something more has happened. What is this something more that has happened? We're also baptized into Christ, where we are identified with him spiritually, right? And because we identified with him spiritually, we identify with his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension. So what Christ did 2,000 years back has meaning or implications for our lives today. So how does it have meaning or implication for our life today, or how does it matter to you and me today? That is what Paul goes on to explain. He says, so we should walk in newness of life. That means our resurrection is telling us that we have to walk in the newness of life. The word life here is the Greek word zoe, and we know zoe is the eternal life, the God kind of life, the fullness of life which God has in himself, okay? And it means the newness of the God kind of life. So he's saying now we are able to live in the abundant life of God, the life that God has in himself. And that is the life we are walking in. That's the God kind of life. And that's God's nature that is is in us and that we have received and that we will live out of from. Okay. So we'll stop here. We'll look at verses 5 from tomorrow's a holiday. So we'll look at it next week. Any questions before we end class? Any questions? Okay, if there are no questions, then we'll end class today. Thank you all for joining class. I've posted the assessment. You all can submit it tomorrow by end of day 23:59. Okay, yeah. Thank you all. Have a blessed day. God bless. Thank you.